Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Sacred Heart of Jesus, we trust in you. Immaculate Heart of Mary, cause of our joy, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Welcome. Today we are going to talk about faith in God. And especially going to the roots of our older brothers who are, you know, the people of Israel, the Israelites. And what is it that defines the faith of God that Israel has brought to the history of salvation? What is it that is specific or special about the faith of God in Israel? First thing I want to do is to put here, so that you have already a visual of what we are going to do. I'm going to give you a summary of everything in a minute and a half. First of all, we had to talk about what is the meaning of, can you see this? Is it big enough? Name. By the end of the day, I want to be able to have you a clear idea of what is a name, what is a concept, or an idea. Idea. Name of God, the concept of God. We're going to go from the Old Testament, Exodus 3, all the way to the New Testament, John 17, basically. Because that's the brackets that are going to help us. There is some points here that we will also talk. There is one text, beautiful text. It's not really, it's before Exodus, it's Genesis. But I will mention Genesis 32:30. And also Judges, at least I have to remember the number 18. What is this? Judges 13:18. Okay. First thing is, what is it that is the first moment in history of Israel that God says something about himself? Do you remember a text from the Old Testament? Okay, remember what is the content of Exodus 3? Who are the two protagonists who are speaking to each other? God and? Actually, I think it's Moses. Let me just check it. Yeah. Moses, he's shepherding, tending the flock, and then he sees what? The burning bush. No political, you know, things about, you know, bush, you know, it's election day after election day. I'm not doing any campaigning, you know. He saw the burning plant. The burning bush. And he approaches the burning bush. We can read it so that we can make it a little bit more, you know, intentional here. Now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush, and he looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Moses said, I will turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. Then he said, do not come near. Put off your shoes from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. And he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. First thing is that God defines himself naming a relationship. I am the God of your father, of Abraham, of Isaac, of Jacob. So he refers himself, calling somebody else into the equation, so to say. He doesn't say, I am the Almighty. He doesn't say, I'm the Creator. He doesn't say, I'm love. He says, I'm the God of your fathers. Then they kept talking, and then Moses says to God, if I come to the sons of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? So, maybe waiting for some special, the Almighty. God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the sons of Israel, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say this to the sons of Israel, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever. And thus I am to be remembered throughout all generations. This is my name forever. So there is two things. He says, I am, wow, we have to throw this away. He says, I am who I am, and I am the God of your fathers, the God of your fathers. That means, you know, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Two things there. And this is my name forever. This is my name forever. Does it satisfy you? Because that's the difference between the name and the concept. Well, I'm going to explain to you that I am who I am. It sounds a little philosophical, right? And when the Bible was translated from the Hebrew into the Greek, those translators who were aware of the Greek philosophy and the Greek thinking, for sure, probably, when translating, added to the understanding of that their mentality, which is normal, because a translator normally brings something to the equation, right? It seems philosophical. I am who I am, like trying to grab the essence, the nature of that being. God seems to be defining himself with words that are philosophical, on the realm of being, the being, you know. I am who I am, which is the essence of God. And the fathers of the church actually followed that thinking too, as they were aware of the Greek culture and the philosophy. And we need to reason our faith, and we use the concepts that we have at hand, right? So I am who I am. But he also said, I am the God of your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So when we come to the to defining what a concept is, what you want to do is to enter into the nature, to grab the nature of something, understand the essence, and give a name. And the way you want to give it a name so that you can pretty much talk, first of all, and you can communicate, but you want to have a certain dominion over the thing, and you have it because you can see the essence. When you talk about a name, you are not much interested in the essence of the thing, but you want to have a relationship with that reality. Because I know that you are a woman, and you too, and you're a man. That's your nature, that's your essence, a man, a human being, man, male or female. But I do not have a real communication with you unless I use your name. Right? If I say, you know, Joe or Christine or Nate, it directly connects. And actually, when you fall in love with somebody, you want to know the name. You don't want to say woman, right? Hey, woman. You really make sure you find the name of that person, right? And there are many different tricks to do that, right? Because the name directly puts you in that perspective of a relationship. So the interesting thing in a nutshell, what I'm trying to tell you is that already here in the Old Testament, when it comes to the faith in God, we see both sides of the same coin. There is a more philosophical, if you will, approach to it. I am who I am. What is the meaning of that? Well, it's impossible to completely grasp me. You cannot, we cannot, I cannot put God in my head. Enclose him, contain him in a concept. But at the same time, he's the God of our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. So that means that he has, to some extent, a relationship, a personal relationship. Not of your fathers only, of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Each one of them different, unique, for their own sake. So the word that in, and I'm going to use this, that appears in the Bible that you may have heard many times is Yahweh, right? Let me see. Yahweh. Actually, you know, in Hebrew they don't write the consonants, the vowels, you know? So it's the tetragram that sometimes if you see this, that's Yahweh. Yahweh, Yahweh. And that has a root that we are not sure which is the root. I mean, it could be Haya. You know? Which is connected to that idea of being. Being. So that's why from Yahweh, if we try to find something like Yahweh, Haya, it connects each one of us to the idea of being. Right? Now, that's the one, Yahweh. And the name of God, it's, as you know, the people normally don't pronounce it today, you know. Actually, down the road, they refer to him because it's impossible to say the name of God. He is beyond our reach to some extent. They start to use Adonai, which is Lord, Adonai. Because you don't say the name of God in vain, you know. You can't be stoned if you do that. So in reality, is it a way to name God that only Yahweh? What is the meaning of Yahweh? The context of that word is that of many cultures and many other gods. And they have to come up with a name for God. But the final stage of any philosophical thinking is not just to thinking of a name that the essence declares itself, you know. We can name God only because he has named himself. When philosophers start to think, the final stage of that supreme being, the foundation of everything, whatever you want to call, it's out of our reach, so to say. So you cannot completely name it. You cannot completely label it. Okay? That's one side. It turns out that also Israel had another contact with other cultures, and one of them is the Babylonian kingdom. And they have another word in those in that culture that is with this Yao or Ya prefix or syllables. And those make a reference to some extent to something is mine. My God, a possessive. So Yahweh may also have the influence of that Babylonian, you know, culture and word and language, which has a more connected meaning with mine, my God. So it makes it more personal. Whereas the I am who I am, the Yahweh with the Haya root could be more out of our hand, or our reach. The way to explain Yahweh with this resource, the Babylonian culture, speaks more about a closeness, a proximity, a relationship. So there are the two, you know, if you will, ways, main ways, about many other things, I'm sure, I'm not a Bible scholar, you know, to explain that. So the linguistical root of the Yao has a personal dimension, more personal dimension. So we have one more philosophical, the concept of God and the idea of faith in the Old Testament, a more personal, approachable. He's at hand, he's close. Okay. And all this is because we are trying to explain Exodus 3, you know, the encounter between Moses and God. Let's go to the next point. The next point is that, if you have a little knowledge of the Bible, is that in reality, Yahweh is not the only way that the scripture refers to God. Indeed, there is another whole tradition in the Bible, which is Elohim, which has a very specific approach. I'm going to write it down. Elohim. I'm going to put it here. Elohim. So not only Yahweh, but Elohim. There are two main traditions in the Old Testament, and you can identify the origin of certain texts by the use of the word. So there are certain texts in the Bible that refer to God as Yahweh. That's a whole tradition in the reduction, the writing of the Bible. Another one is God is Elohim. So it's different tradition. They are both true and both, of course, inspired, but it tells something to us. What is it that it tells us? Elohim refers to a personal God, not to a local God. What do I mean by that? And this is also, I have taken most of this from Ratzinger. As I told you, I'm just following some of his writings and teachings. You know. In any culture, we have this idea of an awesome presence that it inspires awe, and therefore awesome. And sometimes we connect that experience to a place. Right? This is an anointed place. We still have that in our Christian culture. We have places of special presence of God. In our Catholic culture, we also have special presence of Mary. So if you want to go on a pilgrimage, it's a local place. You have to go to Lourdes or to Fatima, wherever it is. Okay? This concept of Elohim is not just referring to a particular place. Because then, the only way to connect with the divinity is to go to that place. Or to designate a place as sacred. And you consecrate the church. You consecrate a piece of land. And you enter into that piece of land, see, like the bush, you know, barefoot. Because there is God's presence here. Is a local idea of God, a local God, you know. You go to certain shrines. You multiply places where you say that it is a special presence of God. Sanctuaries, altars, you know, places, shrines. In reality, the idea behind Elohim is that God is personal. Wherever a man or a woman is, there is the chance and the place to encounter God. It's not just a place. But God is a personal God. We could say the God of our fathers. So we want to encounter Him. He's always near. He's the one whose power is boundless. We understand God with the I, you categories. Not the here, but the I and you. So whether there is a human person, somebody who is using their freedom, their reason, there is God. So there are three notes behind this Elohim concept. God as a creator, as a supreme being, wise, he's above all other things, but also is close to us and orients us to the future. So if it is a place, you pretty much handcuff the presence of God to a place. you kind of enchain, you know, that reality. You had to go there. You had to go to the Vatican. Wouldn't it be great if we had the obligation to go at least once a year to the Vatican? You know? Like other traditions, like the Muslims, you know, the pilgrim to the Mecca, you know. I'm all for it, you know. Elohim indicates also not just a personal idea of God, but a plural. Elohim, it's plural with the him, the I am. Elohim refers to more than one. Already in the Old Testament, there is this perception that we cannot put God into our categories of singular or plural. It's beyond that. It is not necessarily, it's not clear for sure that Elohim, as it is a plural, reveals the Trinity. The Trinity, one God, three persons, is only possible to know through the revelation that Christ brought. But already in the Old Testament, you see, with this Elohim, this use of the plural, that there is a special awareness that you cannot say that God is only one or many. It's not just one of the many. It's above all those realities. It's different. It's everything divine. That would be the idea behind the Elohim. It's not just two or three or four. He's everything divine. He encompasses whatever divine is. That's him. You cannot have any divinity beyond him. Do you follow? Is it too philosophical? Are you going already having a headache? So it's Exodus 3, two different ways in the Old Testament, Yahweh and Elohim. Yahweh, is it from more the Greek philosophical thinking or from the Babylonian root expressing relationship? And then how about Elohim, the other tradition, the other name, you know? It already tells you about a certain above and beyond our categories of one or more. Everything with that plural is expressed. We also know that in the Old Testament, the faith of Israel in God rejected particularly two realities. One is Baal, like the Lord, and the other one is Moloch, or Melech, the king. In what way? God does not want to be identified. God does not want to be identified with the concept and the reality that are used by other cultures or people. Baal is more connected to fertility, and God doesn't want to be just only connected with that and with any particular dimension that is reducing him to that. Or Moloch, the king, you know, the aristocracy, the idea of God for only some people, you know, and detached, far away, like the king gold, you know, and the he wants to approach the people. He is close to the people. He's not just up there, a God only removed from reality or for, you know, the king God. No social pattern, you know, no classes, so to say, you know. He's at reach. So we have already, just to summarize, Exodus 3, Yahweh, Elohim. How about Yahweh? Does it come from more the Greek thinking in the philosophical being realm? Or how about Yah or Yah, more personal God, close to the person? We have also, this is a great explanation, these two texts, that we always want to know the name of God. And there is those two people in the Old Testament who teach us to think about that. Manoah, in the book of Judges, had a vision and said to the angel of the Lord, "Please, let us detain you and prepare a kid for you." And the angel of the Lord said to Manoah, "If you detain me, I will not eat of your food. But if you make ready a burnt offering, then offer it to the Lord." And Manoah said to the angel of the Lord, What is your name? So the angel is asking him to offer a sacrifice, an offering, and he wants to know the name. What is your name? So that when your words come true, we may honor you. See? Intelligent is Manoah, you know. I just want to know your name. Not curiosity, but just so that we can truly honor you when your words come true. Like a prophecy, so to say. And the answer of the angel is, why do you ask my name, seeing it is a secret, seeing it is wonderful, like beyond your reach, so to say. So this is this constant obsession to know the name of God. An example of how the people of God are trying to understand, what is your name? Genesis 32:30 is one of my favorites, actually. Is that the battle between Jacob and the angel of the Lord. It is really good. So you know that Jacob had a little issue with Esau, you know, and they were a little bit fighting and who goes his way. And then Jacob had a little fight with the Lord, with the angel of the Lord. By the stream, the same night he arose and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and set them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. And Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he touched the hollow of his thigh, and Jacob's thigh was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. It's a very dramatic, you know, situation. Then he said, let me go, for the day is breaking. But Jacob insisted, said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And he said to him, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. He said, your name shall no more be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have striven with God and with men and have prevailed. Then Jacob asked him, tell me, I pray, your name. But he said, why is it that you ask my name? And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, saying, for I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved. So Jacob, for one, he's a man obsessed with the blessing. Remember that he stole the blessing from his brother, being cunning. I mean, the guy had almost obsessive compulsive disorder with the blessing, you know? Really, I mean, he stole the blessing from his brother. Then he goes and he's going to meet his brother to see how they're going to be, you know, make amendments and just be at peace. He's on his way and he wrestles with the angel of the Lord, with God, that we many times do wrestle. God inflicts a little mark on him, some pain, that he'll have his whole life. And then, after all the fight, what is his request? Bless me. I mean, the guy... And he's a saint, right? I mean, when we die, we'll go to heaven. Hopefully, we'll see him. So we'll have to ask him, how did you have that OCD with the blessing? But the angel didn't tell the name. And he was aware that he had seen God. And he was spared his life. Because in the Old Testament especially, you cannot see God and still be alive, you know. All the prophets, Isaiah also had a vision, you know, of the Lord. And he was shaking that, how is it that I'm not dying, you know, after seeing the angel of the Lord? So the point is that because of not being able to say the name of the God, because it almost signified nothing and everything, they ended up using Adonai, you know, in the Old Testament. So what does it mean? What does it mean, the name of God, Yahweh? It's not just a name expressing the nature. It's not just a concept. It has a presence. It shows a presence. God is, not becomes. In the Deutero Isaiah, the second Isaiah, when it is just the exile is about to finish, Isaiah 44 says, I am He, I am the first, and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. I am He. Like you have a relationship with a He. I'm the first and the last. Besides me, there is no God. Ego eimi, I am in Greek. He is the one who stays in the midst of the ruins of appearance. And the Babylonian kingdom fell and God still prevailed, you know. So now we go fast forward. So even in some of the texts, you know, well, this is, I'm going to just put it in understandable. Ego eimi. This is Greek. I am. I am. That's the way in the Old Testament, the last part of the reduction of the Old Testament, the name of God is also expressed. I am. I am the one who is the first and the last. Besides me, there is no God. So far, we have what God has to say about Himself, and it's very cryptic, very difficult to enter. But it's not just an idea, a philosophical concept. It talks about a relationship, the God of our fathers. Now, we fast forward all the way to the New Testament. And the New Testament, John chapter 17, is almost the, in a nutshell, the essence of the revelation of Christ. Because John 17 speaks at least four times of the name of God. And we are all the effort we are making is to understand what is it, the biblical faith of God. And the name of God is the first thing to understand the faith in the name of God. John 17 has been called the priestly prayer of Jesus. He prays for the church and prays for everybody. And he is all the time speaking about the name. I read. I have manifested your name to the man whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. While I was with them, I kept them in your name. Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me. I made known to them your name, and I will make it known that the love with which you have loved me may be in them and I in them. If we go, see, the point is that Jesus is now speaking about the name of God, that He is revealing His name, God's name, to us. If we go to John 18, when Jesus is arrested, then Jesus, knowing that all that was to befall him, came forward and said to them, whom do you seek? Whom do you seek? They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. He said to them, I am He. I am He. Anihu in Hebrew. When He said to them, I am He, they drew back and fell to the ground. Again, He asked them, whom do you seek? And then Jesus said, I told you that I am He. So if you seek me, let these men go. So it's almost evident the conclusion of the process of the thinking? What's your name? I am who I am. Second is Isaiah. I am He, the first and the last one. Besides me, there is no other God. Now, these people, you have to think about good Jewish people who are zealous for their faith. And Jesus says, Anihu, Anihu. Which in Greek is ego eimi. Ego eimi. I am He. I am. When He says that, the good Jewish people kind of fall back to the ground. He just said the name of God. So, seeing God is now seeing Jesus. I mean, Jesus is claiming, with all the baggage, the tradition of the Old Testament, He is using the categories and the tradition and the culture of the Jewish people to say, I am who I am. I am the God of your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It's me. I am He. And God is my Father. I am the Son. So, to see even more in a dramatic way how deep this truth is, we can go to Matthew 26. And the high priest said to Him, I adjure you by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God. Jesus said to him, you have said so, but I tell you, hereafter you will see the Son of God, of man, seated at the right hand of the power, not to say the name of God, and coming on the clouds of heaven. Then the high priest tore his robes and said, he has utterly uttered blasphemy. Why do we still need witnesses? You have now heard this blasphemy. What is your judgment? They answered, he deserves death. So the point is, Jesus saying the name of God sentences himself to death to save us from death. He utters the word, the name of God, that is Him, Himself, and doing that, He operates, He triggers, finally, you know, all the process of the passion, death, and resurrection. He has conducted it. Nobody could find a proof against Him. He has led the process, and He has pulled the trigger to just precipitate, just to just catalyze the salvation. I am He. So that's why the way we have taken from the Old Testament, it goes down to Jesus. And in reality, if you think about the image, what Jesus is doing is He's saying, I am the burning bush. I am He. In fact, Origen quotes or attributes to Jesus as saying that who approaches me approaches fire. You know, it's not a quote from the Bible, but it's a tradition handed down from one generation to the other that puts in the mouth of Jesus those words, you know, to approach me is to approach a fire. It is the burning bush. So Jesus is not just an idea. The name of God is not just an idea. He is the name. So, next time we make the sign of the cross. Just think about that. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let me read you from a book written by a great theologian, which is one of the five functions of the priests in the Old Testament. Well, I tell you. Well, one is to be the man of the oracle, to utter the word of God, to be the man of the sanctuary, to be the man of the sacrifice, the man to declare or not the ritual purity and the healing of the lepers. They had to go to the priest so that he would just say it is clean or not, you know. And he's the man of the blessing. So in the Old Testament, the priest had the job description or the function of being the man of the blessing. To bless with the name. He had the function of blessing the people with the name, as Sirach says, Sirach 45. To bless with the name. What is the meaning of that? To bless with the name. Remember, Jacob, tell me your name. Bless me, tell me your name. Blessing and name go together. The book of Numbers describes exactly in this sense the way in which the priests are to bless the children of Israel. The benediction formula repeats the name of the Lord three times. And after having pronounced it himself, God concludes, "In this way let them impose my name on the children of Israel." Numbers 6:27. So the priests in the Old Testament were to repeat the name of the Lord three times. Of course, not making the sign of the cross, because did you know? But to bless, repeating the name of the Lord three times on the people. And then, let them impose my name on the children of Israel. What is the meaning in the biblical theology of that action of putting the name of God upon someone? To put the name of God upon somebody is to establish a personal relationship between God and that person. The benediction is therefore nothing other than effecting a life-giving relationship with God. To establish a personal relationship with God. When I bless as a priest, a congregation, or an individual, what I'm doing is I'm almost like linking that person in a life-giving relationship with God. And at the beginning and at the end of the Mass, we start in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Please don't ask me why bishops do three crosses, because I don't know, you know. A boy asked me one day, why do they do that? He said, I don't know. Even later in the story of Israel, priests were not authorized to pronounce the revealed name outside the temple, but had to use other designation of God. And that even in the solemn ceremonies of the temple, the high priest had to take care not to pronounce the name out loud. Even the high priest in the temple, he should be careful not to be too loud. He was barely to murmur it, to swallow it. Rabbi Tarfon used to say, "I was keeping my place among the priests, my brothers. I strained my ears toward the high priest and I heard him swallow the name in the midst of the chants of the priests." Almost like a mysterious way. See, it's really telling. I mean, the idea of blessing somebody and giving the blessing is one of the most important functions, you know, that God bless you, we say in America, you know, God bless you. So Jesus is the name. So let's recap a little bit. The idea of the concept goes to the essence, the nature. And yeah, I mean, God also, through Jesus, his son, has told us that God is love. I am love. What is the nature of God? Energy, power, love, mercy, love, self-giving, a communion of persons, you know. But because the name of God is love, it by necessity implies and signifies a relationship. So in God, the essence, his essence tells, you know, everything of his own life, you know. And the reason of our faith is that God is love, and therefore the name of God is showing a relationship. God makes himself nameable in Jesus. He enters within our reach. He hands himself over to man. God, revealing his name, hands himself over to man. But revealing his name is revealing Jesus. And Jesus all he does is to hand himself over to lay his life down for us. The only thing we need to know is to grab him. God in Jesus becomes the one who can be invoked. Jesus in coexistence with us. So there is always two points to always balance when we talk about God. On one side, he is personal. He approaches me. But it's always because of his free gift. It's a gift that we receive. We are not entitled to it. So he approaches us in a personal relationship, but he's also this timeless, you know, out of time, out of our reach, you know, a God who gives himself freely and that we cannot fully grasp. So at the same time we defend God's proximity, we have to defend his complete transcendence from the world. He's above and beyond everything. He's a being, love, timeless, you know, beyond our power, control, beyond our complete reach. So it's always to state something and also make a little correction, you know. That's how good theology happens. You cannot be always categoric, you know, like, this is it, and there is no discussion about this. There is always that veiling and revealing. Revealing and veiling that takes place when it comes to God. And God is the closest, but the deepest mystery as well. When we think we have gotten it, he escapes. It's like, imagine, oh dear Lord, I don't know if this is a good example. You know, you're a fisherman, and you have this wonderful salmon you just caught. You're just reeling it in. No. And you're just taking it. And imagine you put a lot of oil in your hands, right? A lot of oil in your hands. And now you go try to grab the salmon now. It's just, and the more you squeeze the salmon, even the faster it goes away, right? We only receiving him, we can completely, as much as our nature, you know, and our ability enables us, hold him. So God is a tremendous mystery. It's a tremendous mystery. So that's when people, you know, use the name of God, you know. You wonder if they know what they are saying. Sometimes there is no doubt about the intention of maybe of being hurtful, you know. But really, I mean, it's almost ridiculous, you know. If you think about what we are trying to sometimes say, we cannot. We hurt ourselves, you know, we hurt ourselves. So it's always good to have good expressions at hand that are really nice, you know. Praise the Lord instead of other words, or, you know, dear Lord, thank you, or oh my, you know. If we were to live always thinking about this, we'll die, you know, like Isaiah is like, oh, you know, what am I doing? What am I saying? You know? It is very, very interesting to think about the name of God. And the name of God is Jesus. So the good thing is that Mary really was cuddling, and rocking the name of God, you know, because Jesus is the name of God, you know. The name of God, God is with us. God is with us. So I hope the intention of these talks is also to help you have more appetite to know the faith. And to say, yeah, I think I know, but I know I could know better, you know. And to have the interest of having good readings, you know. That's why the year of faith, it's important for us to reflect about the meaning of faith and what is the faith that Israel teaches us. And things that the Pope has been telling the last few weeks is that faith is a personal relationship with Jesus and with the Lord, which is another way of explaining the same topic, you know, the name of God, you know. Yes, to say the name of God, to say the name of Jesus, is a prayer, you know. Because calling the name of the person, we are trying to establish a relationship with that. And actually the Bible teaches us to call out, to call on the name of Jesus. And we pray in Jesus' name, you know. And just to say the name of Jesus or the Lord, you know, it's a great prayer. And we need not to repeat it many times, you know. Sometimes people, I don't know, repeat Jesus like 150 times almost. Seamlessly, you know, it's just say less times Jesus, but say it more meaningfully, you know, just. But at any rate, each person prays in a different way. If somebody likes to repeat unceasingly, you know, the name of Jesus. But the name of Jesus is the name of God, and to call upon his name is to establish a personal relationship. Remember now, I'll probably give a few minutes for you if you want to ask something or say something, share something. How is it that when Jesus rose from the dead and Mary Magdalene was crying at the entrance of the tomb, and the angels told her, "Woman, why are you crying? No, woman, why are you crying?" And, "Well, they have taken my Lord and I don't know where he is. If you know by chance where he is, tell me and I will take care of him." And then Jesus shows later and he says, "Mary." And it was not the first word because she was still crying, but when she heard the name of Mary, you know, "Mary, Rabbuni, Master, my master, my teacher." So also for Mary, she didn't say Joshua or Joshua or Jesus. She said Rabbuni, because it's the way that she had that personal relationship with Jesus. So this is the mystery, that even if God has a name that is only one name, he kind of, revealing himself, adjusts himself to each one of us. Like he's invocable. And once we have understood who he is, the mystery of who he is, he makes himself approachable and available and reacts to our talking to him with our own words. Because it's not being said that it's better to say Jesus than Lord, than Christ, than Father, than Brother, than Lord, Savior, my love, my Redeemer. But it is that personal relationship. I always say this, I mean, I normally ask people when I talk to them, how do you call Jesus? Or how do you call God in prayer? And sometimes people are surprised. It's like, I don't know, God. How are you calling this? But other times people go straight and tell you something very personal. I remember this lady, a young adult woman. She said, "How do I call God? Lover of my soul." That's the way she calls in prayer, you know. Another one may say, "My Lord." Not just Lord, but my Lord. One may say Father, you know, because Jesus is also a Father of our souls, you know, of our life, you know. So it's good to know. And the other question would be, how is it that your faith helps you be called by God? How does God call you? Because maybe reading the Bible or any other book, you may have a better connection with God whenever you think about yourself as son, I don't know, daughter, friend. Jesus says, "I have called you friends." Like, how do you say friend in Polish?
Przyjaciel.
Przyjaciel Edita, you know. My friend Edita, you know. They're the real deal from Poland, really. You see, and that's the point. That's when it... Because then, otherwise, we are frustrating the very same intention of God when revealing his name. When God reveals his name, it's not that we know him and we fear him and we respect his law and don't mess around. He reveals his name that we have a personal relationship with him. So you have, and we can conclude here. So we go back to the burning bush. What's your name? I am who I am. It could be if any one of us say, who is God? God is the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, born of the Virgin Mary. And God is the Holy Spirit. But also, it could be in a more personal way, I am the God of your fathers. This is great, because it also gives a family dimension in our life. See, it's not just an individualistic approach to God. He's my God, me, mine for me, always just me. Right? He's the God of your fathers. And it's great to see that the faith has been given to us within a family tradition. Within a family tradition. The God of our fathers. And I'm going to pray that I do this, because I have to find the time. I want to write a little, probably thinner than this, booklet about faith, so that I can publish it for spring, maybe, or early summer, so that then instead of telling you, go to that book, what I have time to with my brother priest, because we have always dialogue, where we can make more approachable, then we can publish. And I found out that you can do that in Amazon. It's amazing. Isn't it crazy? No. Forget about publishing 1,000 books and having a stock. And then you order as you need. You don't have to store them. It's incredible. So pray that I do it. I'm pushing myself, because now that I have told you, I have no choice, you know. It's going to be really bad now. Delete that part of the video. So we have 2 more minutes. I don't know if you want to say anything about that. I mean, the name of God, the faith of God in the Old Testament. There is many, 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 many things that you can say about the faith, the biblical faith of God. I mean, and one of them is that it helps Israel to go beyond their schemes. God always adjusts himself to God, to the Israelites, the God of your fathers, but he's always pushing them a step further. You cannot get stuck with your own traditions, because God is bigger than our traditions too. So you have to adjust and open up to the universal call that Israel had to go through. Yes, Debbie.
Did Jesus cry out Elohim or Elohai on the cross?
Eli, I think. Eli, Eli, El. Lamach sabachthani. Yeah. Eli, Eli. And then they saw he's calling Elijah, you know. But he was quoting Psalm 21, 22. She's right, because there is, you know that there is a different way to number, you know, the Psalms. They split one into two later. So that's why if you go to the Bible, for example, you go Psalm 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 9, 10, it's okay. But now if you go to the rest, some of them, it says 14 and into brackets 13, because it depends on the way you are counting them, with 2 different ways to number them. So it's true, it's a 21 or 20, 22 or 21 into brackets. It depends really on what counting you do. My God, why have you forsaken me? When Jesus quotes that, it's another way in the biblical tradition, in the Jewish tradition, to refer to the whole text. It's as if you say, I always explain, and the American soldier sang, oh, say, have you seen? And nothing else. But everybody would understand that he's singing the national anthem. If it is a person not from America, would just think, oh, he just sang, oh, say, have you seen? So what? What have you seen? You know what I mean? So it's a way to quote it. It's good, because then if you read what he was saying, Eli, Eli, Lamach sabachthani, at the end of this psalm, there is a word of hope. So if you had to read through it till the end, Because he's making a confession at the end of the prayer, which is a prayer, that God will prevail. God will prevail. And in fact, it's a very great thing to read all the text till the end. I will proclaim, listen to this one. That was great, thank you. You gave me the cue, I didn't prepare this. That he will proclaim his deliverance. Jesus says that, I pray in that psalm, that he will proclaim his deliverance, you know. God is a savior. Remember the name of Jesus? And his name, he shall be named Jesus, because he shall save his people. And he ends up praying Psalm 22, 21, saying that Jesus will proclaim, he's making it his own, his deliverance to a people yet unborn. So Jesus, according to the testimony of the Gospels, prayed and died praying, and his prayer with the psalm is that he will deliver, that God will proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn. Jesus is dying and he's saying that. God will proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, that I am dying now because of my death. They are still unborn, you know, they will be born through me, so to say. It's great. Thank you. If you hadn't had that question, and you too, then I wouldn't have been able to say that. So any other thing? Should we? Yes, Kristen.
What's the significance of El Shaddai? I mean, it's a title of...
El Shaddai? I don't know the translation, really. I have to admit that. But let's do this. Let's do this. For next week, you find out what it is. Anyone knows what El Shaddai is? Said is Lord.
God of the Shekinah.
God of the Shekinah. See, there you go. Come here. Kayla. Come here and explain. Yeah, come. Don't worry, come. Don't worry. Are you worried? Are you afraid of the mic?
Yes.
No, come here. Don't be afraid. She will explain to you. She's a Bible scholar, so.
El Shaddai is from, El is the name of it's a generic word for God, how Father was saying, and Shaddai is from the Shekinah glory, which was the Shekinah seat is the wings of the cherubim on the Ark of the Covenant.
The glory, right.
So the Shekinah glory is the glory of God that is in the temple. So El Shaddai is the God of the glory.
There you go. She's a Bible scholar.
I just want to say this is the quality of people we have in RCA.
Yeah. Yeah. See, I didn't know that, so I learned something new. I did know that Shekinah is glory, but I never knew that the El Shaddai is from that derivative, you know, from Shekinah, the God of glory. So, you know, you always learn something new, you know. Next time, you don't have to explain it. But you owe her a coffee, at least, you know. Let's pray to Almighty God and say his name for each one of us and for our nation, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning,
is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.